Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. Time for this month's Q&A. I hope you will enjoy it. I suggest you watch them all if you have the time, or feel free to skip to the questions that interest you. Let's take a quick look at questions for today. First, Hinajin A6, Chen Changqing's books. Second, Nomino, Daozen and Yi Jing. Third, Digger Zhuang, belly breathing versus chest breathing. Question number 4, Eglot 12, Iron Palm risks. Number 5, Super Duranin Pai Da. Question number 6, from MG to Wish, Fever, Xing Yi and Breaking Hands. Question number 7, from CBS, Xing Yi 12 Animals. So, without any further ado, let's get started. The first question is from Hinajan 6, asks, for the Q&A, can you talk about what book Chen Changxing wrote? I heard he has the 3 books but cannot find information about it in English. Maybe wrong information. Chen Xin's book is very famous. Why Chen Changxing is underrated or not known? You also not mentioned here yet. Thank you. So before I answer your questions, let me first introduce Chen Changxing. Since I believe that many of our community members may not know who Chen Changxing was. Chen Changxing was the part of the 14th generation of the Chen family, but the 6th generation of Chen-style Tai Chi Chuan practitioners. He was born in 1771 and passed away in 1853 at about 82 years of age, which was considered a really long life back then. According to Chen family documents, he worked as the caravan bodyguard for decades. In my opinion, his contribution to Tai Chi includes 2 aspects. First, he was the first person who created the 2 routines of Tai Chi that most of the Chen-style Tai Chi practitioners practice even today. And the second, he taught Chen-style Tai Chi to Yang Lu Chan, the founder of Yang-style Tai Chi, which is currently the most popular Tai Chi style. Let's talk about his first contribution, which was the reorganization of Tai Chi routines. Before his reorganization of Tai Chi routines, there were 7 routines in total. Chen Changxing reorganized those 7 routines into the 2 routines that we know today, the first routine and the second routine, or Cannon Fist. Also, before Chen Changxing's time, the Tai Chi structure practiced in Chen Village was smaller. Chen Changxing made the structure bigger, and that is why people call his style Big Frame Chen Style Tai Chi. Most of the later generations of Chen Style practitioners, including Chen Fa Ke, practiced this style. So, after Chen Changxing, Chen Style Tai Chi 2 routines started to exist. That was his first contribution. Let's talk about his second contribution. Chen Changxing was the teacher of Yang Lu Chan. Officially, Yang Lu Chan was the first Tai Chi master who did not belong to the Chen family. This was an unprecedented event since in those days, the Chen village restricted the knowledge of the art only to Chen family members. So, without Chen Changxing, there probably would never have been Yang-style Tai Chi. Now, let's come to the topic of your question. Chen Changxing's 3 books, the 3 books that Chen Changxing wrote were Tai Chi Quan Shi Da Yao Lun, or 10 Important Discussions of Tai Chi, Tai Chi Quan Yong Wu Yao Yan, or Important Teachings of Tai Chi Chuan Martial Application, and Tai Chi Chuan Zhan Dou Pian, or Tai Chi combat. Many people are under the impression that those documents are full-fledged books. In fact, they are not. They are just three articles in different lengths. If you compile them into one document, it may become only a very thin book. Furthermore, his first document, Tai Chi Quan Shi Da Yao Lun, or 10 Important Discussions of Tai Chi, was simply copied from the Xing Yi document titled Jiu Yao Lun, or 9 Important Discussions, along with an additional discussion. Thus, the name 10 Discussions. I have talked about Jiu Yao Lun in a prior video titled Internal Style Concept 26, Si Shao. Please have a look if you want to know more about this document. Link is in the description. All of those documents only include theory. There's no specific practical instruction. However, if you look at Chen Xin's Tai Chi book, Chen Shi Tai Chi Quan Tu Shuo, or Chen Style Tai Chi Illustration, it includes a detailed explanation of a theory, practice, and routines. So, in terms of teaching, I find Chen Xin's literary work to be much superior compared to not just Chen Changxing's book, but also all other works in Chen style. Also, Chen Xin's form is the old small frame Chen style Tai Chi, and Chen Changxing's form is the big frame, which was his own modification of the small frame. They were working on different approaches, so it would be very hard to compare their practice. As Yang Lu Chan's teacher and as the person who reorganized the Chen style routines, Chen Changxing is quite famous in the Tai Chi community. But if we talk about his Tai Chi documents, there's no way to compare it to Chen Xin's book, since Chen Changxing's work cannot even be considered a book to begin with. Also, new research by some historians indicates that even those documents may not have been written by him. I have mentioned Chen Changxing in a prior video titled Tai Chi Quan Building Blocks, Requirements and Expectations. Please watch it if you haven't already. There's a lot of information in that video. Link is in the description. Henina 6, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next question. Nomino asks, what is the role of Yi Jing in Taoism? Before answering this question, let me briefly talk about Yi Jing or the Book of Changes. Yi Jing is one of the five classics of Confucianism. In my video titled Long Force and Short Force, Internal Style Concept No. 5, I introduced the five classics of Confucianism. Also, in another prior video titled Ba Gua Zhang, Building Blocks, Requirements and Expectations, I introduced the Yi Jing or the Book of Changes, including its history and so on. Link to both videos are in the description. Overall, Yi Jing is a classic book in Confucianism. Let's talk about the impact of Yi Jing on Taoism. Well, Taoist practitioners borrowed some concepts and principles of understanding the universe, such as the yin-yang concept, based on Yi Jing and applied them in Taoism. So, a Confucian book has been applied in Taoism by some Taoist practitioners in history. Furthermore, there's a lot of contrast between equivalent concepts in Yi Jing and Tao Te Ching, the latter being the most important book in Taoism. For example, according to Tao Te Ching, yin energy dominates yang energy. Well, according to Yi Jing, yang energy dominates yin energy. So, 易经 has had a marginal impact on Taoism. Nomino, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next question. Digger John asks a question about breathing. He said that there are belly breathing and chest breathing. He said that each kind of breathing uses different muscle areas, the abdominal muscles and the chest muscles. He asks what he should do. In addition, does the length of the breath and the interval between them affect the quality of breathing, and if so, how? Well, different practitioners require different type of breathing techniques in order to maximize the benefits of practice. For example, in Xiu Dao, you should focus on energy breathing, not the physical respiratory activity alone. As for martial art practice, both natural and reverse breathing can be applied. In the Chinese martial art community, natural breathing involves the chest more than the abdomen, while reverse breathing involves the abdomen more than the chest. In other words, reverse breathing initiates the respiratory activity from the abdomen muscles. However, at the end of the day, breathing has to involve respiratory activity, and reverse breathing only applies the abdomen muscle more. In fuzzy movements, only reverse breathing will help you release your power correctly. So, one way to practice reverse breathing is to practice fajin. The abdomen should extend outward during exhalation instead of inhalation, which would be the case with natural breathing. Now, the speed of breathing or the interval between each breath will depend on the speed of martial movements. Again, breathing patterns should follow the body movement and not vice versa. So, the interval between breaths is not an issue at all. You will be fine as long as you manage the coordination between martial movements and the breathing activity. The key factor here is the body movement, while the breathing technique is just the means for coordinating the body movements in the force releasing process. Digger John, I hope I have answered your question. Let's look at the next question. Aglot 12 asks, why iron palm is not good to practice? In more than one of my Q&A videos, I have talked about iron palm practice. What I said was, I believe nowadays iron palm is not a good practice. The reason is very simple. No matter what kind of herbal medicine you use in the process, you cannot avoid injuries in the long run. Well, you may recover quickly when you are young. Iron palm eventually takes its toll with age. All the people I knew that practiced iron palm suffered from physical difficulties in their old age, which would otherwise have been totally avoidable or would have manifested much later in life. The mildest symptom is involuntary shaking of the hand, since part of the nervous system suffered a certain level of damage during iron palm practice in their younger age. Furthermore, their hands also looked very rough and they experienced difficulty performing many daily tasks. In modern times, it's not necessary to practice this kind of skill. You may think that your iron palm will be effective in combat, but most likely you will have already injured yourself during practice before anyone else has the chance to injure you. So the return on investment is so low that it does not make any sense nowadays to practice it. Of course, that may just be my opinion, but it's an informed opinion and I consider it my duty to caution people of the possible consequences. If anyone would like to practice iron palm regardless, that is their choice. Eglot 12, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next one. Super Daruni asks about Pai Da. I'd like to talk about it in today's video. Pai Da consists of two characters. Pai means push or squeeze, while Da means hit or strike. Put together, it means a practice in which you intentionally hit your body with your own hands or others hit you, either using bare limbs or with hard objects like bamboo or wooden sticks, or even metal bars in some cases. It is said that the Shaolin school invented this practice hundreds of years ago and was eventually adopted by many other styles. In the internal style martial art, many people I know practice Pai Da in one form or another. Normally, you start by hitting your body with your own hands and arms, gradually increasing the intensity by using some objects depending on your endurance levels. In order to prevent any unnecessary injury, people usually practice this against a partner instead of resorting to wooden or metal objects. Again, it's best to avoid injuries during practice in modern times, or else you risk jeopardizing the quality of your life during old age. The key aspect of Pai Da is to adjust your breathing when your body gets hit. Normally, for endurance training, practitioners will exhale and tensify the body area that takes the hit. So, coordination between physical movement and breathing is critical. When I used to teach group Xing Yi class in Montreal, I would ask my students to practice Pai Da during warm-up and two-person form sessions in every class. In total, they would practice different type of Pai Da exercise in pairs for about 10 minutes each class. I noticed the result was very good. So, I recommend you make Pai Da a part of your practice, especially if you have a practice partner. But you should take enough care to avoid injuries and not end up practicing iron palm instead. Super Darini, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next question. MG Two Wish Fever says, I have a question, or actually three. I stumbled upon a term in Xing Yi called breaking hands. It comes after Tui Shou in Xing Yi. What is it exactly? And is the Tui Shou practiced in Xing Yi similar to Tai Chi? Or does it use the five phrases fist instead of Tai Chi postures? Interesting question indeed. Let me answer them one by one. To your first question about breaking hands. Breaking hands is actually not a Xing Yi term at all. Instead, it originated in Yichuan, the style created by Wang Xiangzhai around 1930s. Yichuan is based on the Hebei style of Xing Yi. I have briefly introduced Yichuan in some of my previous Q&A videos. I recommend you check them out if you have the time. Basically, in Yichuan practice, Duan Shou or breaking hands is just like free-form sparring practice in any other styles. Duan means breaking, which indicates the nature of Yichuan, a quick and powerful style. To your second question about Xing Yi Puchan. Xing Yi practice does include Puchan exercise called Rou Shou in the Tianjin martial art community, a term similar to Tui Shou used in Tai Chi practice. However, if you are looking for a softer version of a Rou Shou in Xing Yi, I recommend you simply do Tai Chi Puchan for two reasons. First, 形意柔手 is not soft at all. 柔手 used soft force, but 柔手 is not soft. Also, Tai Chi Pushhand is by far the most well-developed practice in the soft aspect. So, what does 柔手 look like? Well, it's a two-person stationary exercise where each one tries to disturb the other's balance by crossing their hand together. I practiced 柔手very well when I was a teenager back in Tianjin, and not many people could defeat me in the park where I practiced. Originally, there was only single-hand 柔手 practice, but about 20 years ago, some people added Tai Chi style of Pushhands into 形意practice, which is fine, but I do not recommend it since that kind of two-hand 柔手effectively ends up becoming Tai Chi Pushhands, no longer possessing a 形意flavor. So, single-hand 柔手 is the traditional way of practicing 形意, while double-hand 柔手 is not.To your third question about five elements in 柔手. Well, 柔手 is a two-person practice, so forces and skills gained through practicing five elements can be used in it. But 柔手 practice is not necessarily limited to the five elements at all. Mr. Fever, I hope I have answered your questions. Let's move on to the final question for today.Sebas asks, is it possible for you to do a video to elaborate more about the purpose and benefit of practicing the 12 animal forms of 形意? It is a good question. Actually, I have briefly introduced this topic in a prior video titled 形意, Building Blocks, Requirements, and Expectations. If you have not watched it yet, please have a look. The link is in the description.It will give you a good overview of the style. However, due to the nature of that video, I did not elaborate on the topic of 12 animals enough, so I'd like to explain in today's video the purpose and the benefits of practicing the 12 animal forms of 形意. The 12 animals are one of the most important practices of 形意. Traditionally, a practitioner starts with the 5 elements.Then they move on to the practice of the 12 animals. The 5 elements focus on the 5 types of energy practice, while the 12 animals focus on 12 sets of techniques. For example, dragon focus on improving the upward and downward energy. Tiger focus on practice of a forward double hand strike.Horse focuses on downward striking energy, while monkey focuses on fast movement in forward, backward, and sideways directions. Other animals have their own distinct characteristics, but these examples should give you an idea. Those 12 sets of techniques may differ between schools, but overall,The objective of practice of the 12 animals is to practice those 12 sets of skills inherited from the characteristics of each animal. There are many other practices after the 12 animals, but unfortunately, many people don't even finish learning all the 12 animals. 12 animal forms are a must-haveIn your skill set, if you want to be a good 形意practitioner. Sebas, I hope I have answered your question. That brings us to the end of this month's Q&A. Thank you for watching. See you next time and enjoy your practice.